Hello students, in this video you will study MySQL unique constraint and how to use unique constraint to enforce the uniqueness of values in a column or a group of columns in a table. Sometimes you want to ensure values in a column or a group of columns are unique. For example, email addresses of users in the user table or phone numbers of customers in the customer table should be unique. To enforce this rule, you can use the unique constraint. The unique constraint is an integrity constraint that ensures values in a column or a group of columns is unique. A unique constraint can either be a column constraint or a table constraint. To define a unique constraint for a column, when you create a table, you can use the following syntax. Create table, table name, okay? Then you define all your columns, and then you could define which column you want to be unique. So you could say column name, the data type, and use the keyword unique. So this will specify your unique constraint for this column. So if you insert or update a value that causes a duplicate in this column, then MySQL will reject the change and issue an error. This unique constraint is a column constraint, and you can use it to enforce the unique rule for one column. To define a unique constraint for two or more columns, you can use the following syntax when creating the table. So create table, table name, mention the column names, okay? Define your columns with the name and the data types. And at the end, you could have the unique keyword, and you specify within the parentheses by comma separation the names of the columns that you want to have unique values. So you just mention the comma separated list of columns in parentheses after the unique keyword. So MySQL will use the combination of values in both column name 1 and column name 2 to evaluate the uniqueness. If you define a unique constraint without specifying a name, MySQL automatically generates a name for it. To define a unique constraint with a name, you can use the following syntax. The constraint is the keyword. Then you give a name for that constraint. Below that, you use a unique keyword and you specify within the parentheses the list of columns separated by commas. Let's look at MySQL unique constraint example. Okay, so let's create a new table called suppliers with two unique constraints. We're creating a table suppliers, okay, with the following columns: supplier ID, name, phone, address. Okay, then we specify the primary key as supplier ID, and then we specify the constraint for this table. So we specify using the keyword constraint. We give a name for this constraint, UC underscore name underscore address. So this is the name of the constraint. And then we use the keyword unique, and we specify the columns that we want to have unique values. So there are four columns: supplier ID, name, phone, and address. So we specify that name comma address should be unique. Okay. So these are the two columns that should have unique values in addition to your primary key. Also, you can see here that phone, this column phone, also has been specified as unique. Okay, so these are different ways of specifying unique. So here in this constraint at the bottom here, MySQL will use the combination of these two columns to check for uniqueness. Okay, so whereas here it will want that each phone number that is entered or inserted into the table is unique. So basically what we have specified is all the columns will be not having duplicate values because this is a primary key, okay? And name and address have been specified using this constraint, okay? That they also should be unique. And we are, while creating the table itself, we have specified that phone number also should be unique. So this is just what I told you. So there are two constraints, phone, and the second constraint is for name and address. So let's insert a row into the suppliers table. So suppose you write an insert query, insert into suppliers, mention the column names, name, phone, address, and the values. Okay, these are the values. So this insert query, when you execute, will run successfully. Now let's write one more insert query, okay, wherein we mention a different supplier but the same phone number as the above query. So this phone number that we are going to try to insert will be the same as the above query, okay? So one phone number that exists in the supplier table. So suppose we try to do the insertion, we have changed the name, okay, but the phone number is the same. Then MySQL will generate an error. It will say something like this: duplicate entry for this. Okay. So since you are entering a duplicate entry and we have already enforced the unique constraint on this column phone, okay, so you will get an error. MySQL will not insert this data into the table. So if you change the phone number to a different number and you try to insert, then the query, insert query, will work successfully. So this query here, if you change the phone number, it will work correctly. Okay. Next, we'll try to insert a row into the supplies table with values that already exist in the name and address column. If you try to insert data that already exists in these two columns, so for example, we write the insert query as insert into suppliers, name, phone, address, values, okay, ABC INC, okay, ABC Inc., and 4000 North First Street. So these are the two values which are already existing. Then MySQL will generate an error saying that the constraint UC name address was violated, and it will say duplicate entry for. So some error message, something similar you will get when you violate the constraint. So I hope you have got a good idea of how the constraints work, how the unique constraint is specified and syntax is defined. Suppose you want to delete a unique constraint, then you can use the following syntax. To drop a unique constraint, you can use the drop index or the alter table statement. So you could use something, the syntax is alter table, table name, and then you could say drop index, index name. When you say when you use this query show create table suppliers, you can see the constraints that have been specified. Okay, so what you can do is you can drop the constraint by using the drop index. So this is the name of the constraint, UC underscore name underscore address. So we can drop this constraint by saying drop index, specify the name of the constraint and on which table. So the table name is suppliers. So again, if you run this query, show index from suppliers, you will see that this constraint will be deleted. Okay. You can run it and check, it will not be present. If you want to again enter a new constraint to the table, you can use the alter table constraint to add a new constraint. So the syntax for that is alter table, the name of the table, add constraint and give some name for the constraint. Then again, you use a unique column, unique keyword to specify a list of columns. It could be one or many. Okay, so list of columns, and end a query with a semicolon. So something like this. We can re-enter the constraint UC underscore name underscore address back to the suppliers table by saying alter table suppliers, add constraint, specify a name for the constraint. So I will give, say, the same name that we had given previously, UC underscore 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 name underscore address. Then I use the unique keyword and specify my columns, name, comma, address. Now let's look at the MySQL check constraint. The MySQL check constraint ensures that values stored in a column or a group of columns satisfy a Boolean expression. So basically, this is the syntax. Constraint, okay, is the keyword. You give a name for the constraint. Check, some Boolean expression you have to specify here. And then you can have not enforced. Okay, so not is optional, and here it is enforced. Again, this is also optional. So if you omit the constraint name, then MySQL automatically generates a name with the following convention: table underscore name underscore check underscore n, where n is some ordinal number 1, 2, 3 dot 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 etc. Okay, so for example, the names of the check constraints for the parts table will be parts underscore chk underscore 1, parts underscore chk underscore 2, and so on. So the constraints will be named like that if you don't specify your constraint name. Second, you can specify a Boolean expression. Okay, here you can specify some Boolean expression which must equivalent to true or unknown for each row of the table. The expression evaluates to false, the values violate the constraint. Okay, so this expression, as long as it evaluates to true or unknown, it is okay. But if it evaluates to false, that means there is something, the constraint is getting violated. You can optionally specify the enforcement clause to indicate whether the check constraint must be enforced. So this is optional. Use enforced or just omit the enforced clause to create and enforce the constraint. Use not enforced to create the constraint but do not enforce this. So if you want to create the constraint but you do not want to enforce it, then you must use not enforced. Okay, not enforced. So it will create the constraint but it will not enforce it. Let's look at some MySQL check constraint examples. Okay, so we are looking at a MySQL check constraint which is a column constraint example. Okay, so the constraint is only specified on specific columns. So here, while creating the table, you can see that we have created four columns. Okay, part number, which is the primary key, description, cost, and price. Okay, now on this cost and price columns, we have specified a check constraint. We have used the keyword check. Okay, and we are saying that check that the value that is being entered here should be greater than or equal to 0. That is, the cost is greater than or equal to 0. Similarly, for the price column, we are putting a constraint that check that price is greater than or equal to 0. Okay. Now, as you can see here, we have not put anything like enforced here. So, it's not necessary that this is compulsory. Okay. It's not to be enforced. It's optional. But since you have put for this, if it evaluates to false, it will give an error. Okay, if it evaluates to false, it will give an error. So after creating the table, you can use the show create table and the name of the table you can give to check for the constraint. So this is the constraint. Okay, We did not give any name for the constraint. Remember, in the previous query, we did not give any name. So your constraint names are automatically generated by MySQL. So it takes the name of the table, parts, okay, puts the CHK to indicate it is a check constraint, and starts that the first constraint is the first one. It starts with the number one. Similarly, for the second constraint, it takes the name of the table, okay, parts. The constraint is specified CHK, and then this is the second constraint, so it goes to 2. Okay, both the constraints are specified here. For the cost column, the cost is supposed to be greater than or equal to 0, and for the price column, the price should be greater than or equal to 0. So now if you try to insert this query, so you are trying to insert a data using the insert query. So you are inserting into the parts table, insert into parts, okay, part number, description, cost, price, okay. So four columns, you are inserting the values. So this is the value that will go to part number, cooler, you will go to description, zero is the cost, and the price is minus 100. So MySQL will generate an error, okay, why? Because we have specified that the check constraint on price, that the price should be greater than or equal to 0. So when you specify your minus 100, okay, so that means that check constraint evaluates to false. This evaluates to false. We had said the price should be greater than or equal to 0. Okay, since this evaluates to false, MySQL will generate an error. Thank you for listening.